us salvation and be before us with a way, a path. And it prepares our hearts for Advent, which starts next week. So we're happy to be with you. It's a Sunday that sometimes goes forgotten in the life of the church year, but it's actually the final Sunday in the liturgical season. So it's an important Sunday. So thanks for being here this morning. We want to remind folks that we are a name tag church. This is, I don't think we have coffee hour this morning, but if you do hang out after church, especially if you have a mask on, wear your name tag so people can identify who you are and say hello to you. It's really helpful.
Georgie's getting coffee going downstairs.
Oh, there might be coffee. So if you go down there and if you're gonna hang out right after church, please wear your name tag. I see at least a couple new-ish people. So it's really helpful for folks who are new. And some of us are super forgetful, so please wear your name tags if you're willing. And there are sticky ones out in the narthex where you likely entered the sanctuary. If you're not wanting coffee, but you want to hang out, Donna Castor, can you raise your hand, at least for folks who are over here? Donna Castor and I are going to lead a little bit of decorating today for Advent. So you can just find myself or Donna, and we would love to get your help. So just check that out if you'd rather move around than stand around, right? We're so appreciative of people who are helping us with worship this morning. Wayne for reading, our tech help, Larry Spencer, our staff, our musicians, thank you so much for being here. Really appreciate it. And a special welcome to anyone who is here for the first time or is returning for a second time. We're always happy to be with you and to worship among friends and family. We ask that you are respectful of other people's personal space. Some of us are traveling, so we might be masking this week to prepare to see tiny babies or people who are older. So just be aware of someone else's personal space if you go in for a hug. They may not want a hug, so ask first. We do have lots of programs, activities, and events in the life of our church, so we encourage you to check that out in our bulletin or find the events listed on Facebook or on our website. There's lots of places where you can get the info, especially during Advent. There's a lot going on. You'll find two important inserts in the bulletin, little floppy pieces of paper. One is about an educational event. I've already announced it, so I'm not going to announce it, but check it out. And one is about the poinsettias, or some people say poinsettias. They'll adorn the church about the second or third week in Advent, and you're welcome to contribute a little bit of money and get a poinsettia for yourself. It's a good part of our ministry, and it's a very kind of historic tradition in many churches around the country. So check that out if you want to. On Tuesday evening, we'll be here for a 7 p.m. service. It will be a time for us to focus on gratitude and the ways that our church is being called to name justice in the world. And so we invite you to come at 7 p.m. on Tuesday night, and it will be a really lovely worship service if you're around. So we hope you show up for that. If you're looking for a Advent practice, something to do during the time of Advent to reflect faithfully, there are actually little books like this. They're blue and cute, easy to carry around. We bought 15 of these from the United Church of Christ. If you want to take one for free, that's fine. If you want to take one at cost, they're about $3.50. So you can put $3.50 in the plate, or you can bring it to the office sometime. But either way, there are 15 of these right up front here. I have a feeling they're going to go pretty quick. So I think if you're here today, then it might be your lucky day. Right on the front pew there. Okay. On December 4th, the church school children are wanting to have a potluck. So we're going to do it. All right. So they can't come to Sunday nighters because, you know, they got to go to bed early. So we're going to honor and respect that our youngest folks want to have a potluck on December 4th. I'm even going to bring something, so I encourage you to show up. So potluck on December 4th rather than coffee hour, so mark that day to bring something easy. You could make it the night before and then bring it on Sunday morning. And December 11th, there's an outreach event happening. There are flyers. I will make sure they're out. I think they're out somewhere, but I will make sure these ones are out on the pew as well. I have one more announcement, and then Peggy has one. Sunday Nighters is this evening. I don't see Georgine here, but her house is very, very easy to find. Sunday Nighters is fellowship, fun, and food. She lives on 3 in Holderness. It's about 15 minutes from here. So if you need directions, just let me know and I'll make sure you get those directions. You do need to be vaccinated to go to Sunday Nighters. And I think that's all I have. So Peggy, thank you so much for making an announcement, and please pay attention to Peggy's announcement.
Next Sunday, 4:00, right here, we are having a celebration. We are so lucky. We are dedicating our new organ, Joan Campbell Lovett. Please be here. Please bring your friends and family. Everyone is invited. It will be a wonderful event. Our musician is Ethan Hayam, and he is from Yale Institute of Sacred Music, and he has a wonderful program prepared. So hope to see all of you there. It would be wonderful to have this space filled. Thank you.
Great, thank you so much, Peggy. And I know it wasn't just Peggy, of course, who organized this. A lot of people did, and we really appreciate all the efforts that went into that. So show up for that, especially if you like sacred music. It's gonna be really, really cool. So show up for that next Sunday. Anybody else have something I forgot? I think I covered it pretty well. Great. Thank you for being here. If there are issues on Facebook, we do want to know. If you're having a hard time with hearing or seeing or anything like that, we'll do our best to remedy it. But please remember that our Facebook page is a part of our public witness. So it's really important that if you put a comment up there, you're nice and polite to the person behind the screen. You can learn more about who we are by looking at that front page of our bulletin right on the cover. It'll tell you all kinds of stuff. Again, thank you for being here for worship. We are a church together, whether we're here for the first time or it's our 100th or 1,000th time. Welcome, bienvenuto. If you're excited for pumpkin pie or deep fried turkey, welcome to you. If you're feeling happy or sad, welcome to church. If you live with pets or some other people or by yourself, welcome. If you're struggling with the shortening days, well, welcome to church. If you are a believer, a questioner, or a questioning believer, welcome into this space. As we enter into a space for contemplation and reflection, we want you to know that no matter where you are physically, God is surely with you. Let's listen for God's still speaking voice in our introit.
Please join us for the call to worship printed in your bulletin. We bring our humble praise before you. May we be shaped by your love in this hour.
With hope for unity and for peace of all our journeys, we come.
We bring our struggles, our imperfections. We have heard you long to hold us, no matter our circumstance.
With faith that our spirits will be compelled to dare and to change the world.
We bring our dreams, our longings, and our deepest desires to your altar.
With courage and vulnerability, we believe in your divine comfort.
Please join us for hymn number 448 in the Black New Century Hymnal, "Take My Life, God, Let It Be."
Thank you.
to invite you to greet one another with signs of God's love and peace this morning. If you're in this space and you do not want people in your personal bubble, then just give the peace sign and people will know that means please don't come near me. If you're at home, send a note. Please, let's give each other signs of God's love and peace. We'd like to invite and encourage folks to slowly and not in a rushed way head back to your seats if you're here in worship physically. If you're at home, we want to remind you that you can absolutely send a peace note and send someone God's love this morning. You can write something really simple on a piece of paper, peace be with you, God be with you. You can send a text message. You can use the messaging icon on Facebook to send a note. If you write a physical note, make sure that you make a plan for where you will take that note. Otherwise, it will probably end up in the garbage. So you could put it under someone's windshield wiper or inside of a screen door or even in a mailbox. So we are so happy to be with all of you. And we invite you to join us in the order of service. God be with you. Lift up your hearts.
Please join me in the unison gathering prayer. Wonderful and almighty God, we enter your sanctuary with praise and thanksgiving, understanding ourselves to be your creation. We recall that we are indeed loved deeply and that you are beloved. We have come to sing glory and praise.
We invite you to join us in moments of confession. Almighty and everlasting God, you are always more ready to hear than we are able to pray. You're always willing to give more than we desire ourselves. Pour upon us the abundance of your mercy. Forgive those things of which our conscience is afraid. And give us those good things which we believe we may not ask. God, hear your people in humble prayer. You are sovereign and eternal, O God. Your reign is holy. Let us know that your spirit may repair our lives, and let us find your wisdom on this very day. Amen.
Gracious God, we want to have control over as much as possible. We forget about your unfailing presence and your divine protection. Let us be restored. Let us find your assurance and promise once again. May we be found in your love. Let us know in our hearts and minds there is nothing, nothing here or anywhere else that will separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. Speaking this promise, we sing.
Any young folks who would be willing to come forward to the chancel area? Can we make this one happier?
No.
I don't know. This feels pretty risky. Now this one, okay. Maybe now? Okay. Great. Thanks for being patient, everybody. All right. I'm going to give you a big question. I want you to try to give me the most honest answer possible. Okay, I don't need a churchy answer or a answer for the pastor kind of answer, okay? You ready? Answer as quickly and as honestly as you can. And I'll tell you what, the person who answers first, well, I shouldn't make it a competition, but you can call yourself the winner if you're the quickest answer, okay? What is the most important thing? Anything else? Love? Anything else? Okay, well, I didn't expect that, but that's all right. That is a fun answer. You know, us preachers, we love to talk about God, so that's a great answer. And, you know, in the Bible, God is love. Jesus is named as love. So I think that when I was 3 or 4, I probably would have said Hulk Hogan.
I'm older than 3 or 4.
Okay, well, don't worry. Some people remember Hulk Hogan, though, right? Pretty funny character. I even had a little lunchbox. It was all yellow. At age 6 or 7, I probably would have said just running in circles, going to the playground. That was one of my favorite things to do. At 9 or 10, I think I would have said soccer. And at 12 or 13, I probably would have said music. Because, you know, we get our identity in music sometimes.
Well, I love it.
That's super, Maris. I'm really happy to hear that. Yeah, music is so important. And then I think it would have taken until I was 15 or 16 to be as wise as you all are. And then I think I probably would have said God. Right? So now here's the hard question. Why is God the most important?
Because God is everything.
Oh my gosh, that's good. That's really good. So how do you know that?
My mom told me.
Okay, right on. And you know what? You're one lucky kid because your mom is very trustworthy. Yeah. And how do you know? You also said, you said love, right? Yeah. Do you want to tell me more about that? How do you know that love is the most important?
Because God is love.
Because God is love, yeah. And do you have a different answer about why? Wait just a second. Tessa, do you have a different answer about, okay, because God is creator. Tessa says because God is creator, right? So if God is creator, then we can thank God, right? Because we like to be alive and we like things like, well, sometimes in life we like things like wrestling, I suppose, and running in circles. And cheese, I think you said cheese in houses. There's some things we really like.
Trees.
Oh, trees, yes, trees, definitely. There are so many things that someone might say, this is the most important thing in life. And I think Maris's lesson for us is just perfect, and Tessa's lesson for us is perfect. God is creator, right? That's part of what we believe. And God created everything and is in everything. And so we say thanks to God. And that's the point of this Sunday in our church year. Do you need to say one more thing, huh?
Yeah.
Okay.
Me and Tessa kind of had the same idea because God is love. So, like Sarah said. So, No.
It can be so confusing and so clear all at one time. And I think there's actually a math word for that one is the other by way of the process. I think it's deductive reasoning. Is that right? Is that it? Who's the middle school math? Anyway, you guys did some great deductive reasoning for us. And we're going to pray together, and if any of you want to pray, you can just repeat what I say, and this will be our prayer. Ready? Dear God, let us remember that your love is the most important. As we go on this day, let us walk in your way. Amen. Very good. Thank you. All right. You stole my cheese! Oh, Maris. All right, you guys can head to church school and have a good time.
First reading this morning is Psalm 46. It was written to the leader of the Korahites, according to Alamoth. It is a song. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth should change, though the mountains shake in the heart. Though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble with its tumult, Shelah. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. God is in the midst of the city. It shall not be moved. God will help it when the morning dawns. The nations are in an uproar, the kingdoms totter. He utters his voice, the earth melts. The Lord of hosts is with us, the God of Jacob is our refuge. Shelah. Come, behold the works of the Lord. See what desolations he has brought on the earth. He makes wars cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the shields with fire. still and know that I am God. I am exalted among the nations. I am exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Shalom. The second reading is from Paul's letter to the Colossians, chapter 1, verses 11 through 20. May you be made strong with all the strength that comes from Christ's glorious power, and may you be prepared to endure everything with patience while joyfully giving thanks to God, who has enabled you to share in the inheritance of the saints in the light. God has rescued us from the power of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. Christ is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For in Christ all things in heaven and on earth were created, things visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or powers, all things have been created through God for God. God is therefore all things, and in God all things hold together. Christ is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that he might come to have first place in everything. For in Christ all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell. And through Christ, God was pleased to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, by making peace through the blood of his cross. Holy One, we pray that the meditations of our hearts and minds will be acceptable to you, for you are our rock and redeemer. May your spirit move between words and hearing.
Amen.
Eighth grade, for me, well, it was like it was for many other people, painful to say the least. I had been new to the particular school I was in for about 2.5 years. And by the midpoint of eighth grade, I still had very near the lowest self-esteem possible, even though I had been placed on a high school soccer team. And I'd move from the average math class up to the advanced ones. But for most middle schoolers, it doesn't matter how successful you are. Discontent can pour through your veins, just as much as hormones do. It doesn't matter what you've done sometimes. I was almost as proud of my math successes as I was as my soccer successes. There was something about the quiet accomplishment that made my heart just sing. I think I like being challenged a little bit too. But of course, with those mathematical challenges which were set up to prepare many of us for high school honors geometry, came buckets of stress. And stress was not something I had figured out how to deal with off of the soccer field just yet. I wonder which one of you, or which group of you, which of you in here might remember those word problems they would assign in late middle school and early high school. Maybe you saw it in the electronic newsletter this week, and I apologize if this memory is activating for any of you. But I wonder if you remember, for example, a water tank having the shape of a rectangular prism of base of 100 square centimeters is being filled at a rate of 1 liter per minute. Find the rate at which the height of the water in the tank increases. Express your answer in centimeters. Or if you hate geometry, maybe you like money. Danny bought a total of 20 card games, some of which cost 25 cents and some of which cost 15 cents. If Danny spent $4.20 to buy these cards, how many cards of each type did he buy? Okay, now some of you have probably blacked out. So if you're in that space, come back into the sanctuary. It's a safe place. Some of you, maybe you're still stuck on the first word problem, trying to figure it out, maybe trying to solve it. And some of you are thinking, how does this relate to faith? Let's move on now. We're almost there. I promise I will not verbalize any more word problems today. For the most part, I was able to figure out the answers to these problems. I mean, after all, there's some advantages to not having any friends, right? If you're in middle school, plenty of time to do homework. Every once in a while, however, I just could not figure these things out. It was hard to even describe how upset I would get. I sat in the dining room, a small space with a sort of hutch that had some cute and sentimental china in it. I was absolutely fuming. So easy to score a goal in soccer, so hard to figure out how many centimeters. My mom's words still echo in my head. Well, Sarah, I don't remember how to do this type of math. I just don't think I can help. My discontent and hormones would meld into this awful apocalyptic scene, and I would cry out, "What am I going to do? I have to figure this out. We have a test on Friday." Of course, the tears would commence. For some reason, I thought that these math problems were of the penultimate matter in my life. For some reason, it seems like we all think that so much of what we do is the most or the maybe the second to most important thing. We can't let go sometimes of the way that someone else so easily completes a project and does so in a different way. It seems absurd to us, for example, sometimes the way our partners or our family members or friends load a dishwasher. What were they thinking? We seem to forget that verse 16 reminds us all things have been created through Christ and for Christ. Or as theologian Netta Pringle puts it, in Jesus we see that the means and the meaning of creation are found. Again, in Jesus the means and the meaning of creation are found. So she goes on, Netta Pringle, she says, "It is also here in Jesus that the redemption of creation is possible. Our faith in Christ gives us a worldview that is both large enough and consistent enough to address the myriad questions and problems that confront our human lives. Where is humanity going? How should we live? Why am I here?" Our questions are not new. They're the same ones that the psalmist brings up and that Paul writes about in the epistle to the Colossians. He brings these questions to the surface just like the people before him had. Psalm 46, pointing towards this answer of where humanity is going. The nations are in an uproar. The kingdoms totter. God utters her voice. The earth melts. Reading our text metaphorically, we might imagine that the matters of our day-to-day lives, as individuals or communities, they actually melt into the matters of the divine. And with hope, we might see that humanity is indeed able to bring Christ, the divine, into our lives day by day through simple acts of love and kindness. So we begin by recentering, working to recall what is actually of the most ultimate concern. As our kids readily told us, it's not math problems or how people load dishwashers. It's love, who for us is named in Christ. And therefore we will not fear, though the earth should change, though the mountains shake, in the heart of the sea even, the waters roar and foam, the mountains tremble with its tumult. God makes wars cease. God breaks the bow, shatters the spear and burns the shields with fire. In God's realm, there is no war. There is no need for it. And we are called to bring this about in the world in the ways that we're able. Protestant faith traditions like ours sometimes struggle to lean into God being in control, but it is a key part of our faith. And one thing we remember is that this does not give us a free pass on our responsibility to care for our neighbors, saying, oh, God's got this. No, we are called to join God, to co-create, bringing love, bringing justice to those in need, those who have been turned away time and again. It is Christ's reign that calls us all the more to act on the basis of love. He who came as the person Jesus of Nazareth. As much as we want to be in control and figure out answers and do things exactly the way we like to do, our call and our path to the Christian faith demands that we make more space for God, dwell in questions, and be open to the new ways of being in the world. How is God calling the church in this century? God is looking to restore all of us, one and many together. So how will you make space for God this week? The one in whom there is the means and the meaning. How will you be ready to dwell in questions and uncertainties even when it is really hard? And how will you intend to find new creation, knowing that God has brought redemption and restoration for all of us? With Jesus, we find the means and the meaning. And so we may live and sing with this knowledge and a deep sense that this truth can compel our hearts and our spirits. We'd like to invite you to rise as you're able and join us in singing Oh for a Thousand Tongues to Sing. It's in the red hymnal number 223. Please be seated. We'd like to invite you to join us in a time of prayer this morning. There is a list of folks in our bulletin. We always want those who are gathered here or online to look at the list. If you are at home, then you'll need to find our bulletin. It's on our website. Bulletins on our website, and you can easily find that at uccplymouth.org, and I believe the list of folks who are praying for is about halfway through the bulletin if you're looking for it. You could light candles, you could voice names aloud, whatever's natural for you. So I invite you to join us in these prayers. I want to mention that Eileen Torrey is doing well, and we're continuing to pray for her and her family. And so I will say, oh God, in your grace and mercy, and will respond, hear your people at prayer. Does anyone have anything in this space that they'd like to bring up? Yes, Bill. Absolutely. Thank you, Bill. Bill's just mentioning, Bill is Eileen's spouse, her beloved husband, and he's mentioning that everything did indeed go well, but we're continuing our prayers, and that Eileen also mentions that she's really grateful for our prayers. So, thank you, Bill. Oh God, in your grace and mercy, hear your people at prayer. Oh, yes, Beth.
Remember all the victims family members who are affected by hate crimes, as we saw in the bar in Colorado.
Okay. Unfortunately, there has been another hate crime. I've not heard about that yet, but this one was in Colorado.
Last night at a gay bar.
Okay. So we're praying especially for LGBTQ folks, especially in Colorado, and for all people who are targeted by hate crimes and violence. O God, in your grace and mercy, hear your people at prayer. Yes, Jim.
Well, the people that are traveling this week, going to their families and whatever for Thanksgiving.
Yes.
Let's just hope they get there safely and have a good safe trip.
Yeah, Jim is mentioning all the people who might be traveling this week, that people have safe travels and that they get where they're going and back home nice, safe, and sound. O God, in your grace and mercy, hear your people at prayer. I have just a couple of joys I'd like to mention. Many of you have stepped up. As Eileen, you're probably watching Eileen, but if you're going to catch us later, we're so grateful for everything you do. You know that, and we've had a lot of people step up to help fill in some sort of holes. But Bill has especially, but. We're really grateful for y'all's ministry in our church as a couple and as individuals. So that's a great joy. And then I had some lovely people from our congregation help with a move that Libby and I had yesterday, and the cats. So lots of joy for many things. Oh God, in your grace and mercy, hear your people at prayer. Let's turn to God in silence. Glorious God, you have given us the means and meaning. We often think that we can control more than we can, and we forget to simply exist with your spirit. We return to your love today, and we name your reign here on earth and throughout the universe. Today we pray humbly for those who have been lifted in voice and those who have not been mentioned, but we are thinking of. We offer up gratitude for all who serve the church and the world. We think especially of those who work to further the cause of justice, of peace, and of hope. We pray especially for people who are celebrating birthdays or anniversaries in our community. And we're praying for folks who have taken oaths to serve the public. God, humble all of these folks and lead them to think of those who are most in need in our communities. God, bless those in our country who are oppressed and compel those of us who have work to do as we try to bring your love and justice through our human and flawed systems. Holy One, let us all move away from violence in all its many forms. God, point us towards your love over and over. We bring all of our anxieties before you, O God. We're praying for people who are having a hard time with the shortening of days, for those who might be struggling with mental health and for the people who might support them. We pray for people who are struggling to heat their homes and for those who are living outside in shelters or those who have been forced to move into unhealthy and unsafe situations. God, be with folks during the holidays, those who travel, those who are hungry, and those who are lonely. God, we pray for those who have been locked up in prison and those who have been evicted as winter storms rage. We pray for the people in and around Buffalo, for folks in Colorado who have been targeted. God of power and peace, we continue to pray for a consensus on how humanity can care for your creation. Let us remember that we are called to your work. Let us remember that we should repair the world beside you. God, be with those who are persecuted, those who are victims and survivors of war and oppression. God, we pray for people who aren't feeling safe in their homes, that they'll find what they need. God, we pray for an end to violence, for an end to racist policies, and an end to white supremacy. God, we pray that we will all work to break down barriers to healthcare in all its forms. We pray for people who are fighting for the full range of reproductive health care. And God, for those who are working diligently to care for people who identify with the LGBTQ community. God, let us recall your words where you said, "Be watchful then and strengthen the things that remain." God, let us know that we are hidden by your great shadow and let us feel your charge on this very day. So God, hear us as we utter the words you taught us, as we say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Enduring community, church. I have a little comic up here with me this morning. I was gifted this by the Pollocks. It has a that's a couple in our church, if you don't know them. They're wonderful, wonderful humans. It has a picture of two kids hugging, and it says, "A hug relieves tension, improves blood flow, reduces stress, non-polluting, helps self-esteem. No batteries required, absolutely no cost. Extremely personable and fully returnable. Hugs." A picture of two kids. There's so many ways to contribute to a community. Some people like hugs and some people don't. You can show love. You can do that in many ways. One way is to offer financial contributions. One way is to offer hugs or to say hi to someone during coffee hour right after church. Whether or not you plan to be a hugger in church, we invite you to join in the effort of furthering God's mission in the world, God's love. If you're unable to give financially this morning, please know that you are welcome to extend your hand towards the offering plate and imagine that thing that you might give the world or your community this week, maybe a neighbor, something specific. If you're at home and you want to learn more about giving, go to uccplymouth.org/give, and you can find the information you need. If you're sending a check, make sure you send it to Post Office Box 86 rather than our physical address. Our gospel calls us to give love, so let's do that on this very day. We invite you to join us in sharing the mission of the gospel.
Oh,
offertory prayer. God,
God who is love, we humbly bring our gifts today, and we dedicate these to your service and way. Let these gifts be blessed. May these be used to serve the needs of all who are lonely, hungry, and hurting. Let all who are in need know your presence through these, our simple offerings. With thanksgiving, we present these gifts to you, and we bring songs of hope and praise on our lips. We pray all this seeking to find and become redeeming love. Amen.
Please join in singing verses 1 through 5 of hymn number 32 in the Black Hymnal.
Today, make more space for God. Dwell in questions and be open to new ways of being. Remember that in Christ, we are granted the means and the meaning. So as you go, tend the sick, share a meal, even if from afar or over the phone. If people ask you where you've come from, say to them that you're God's child and that you have seen love in Christ. Please be seated. Thank you.